Thank you very much. So let's start now. So my plan today is to present to you the work of the International Telecommunication Union in the field of satellite systems, especially in the use of radio frequencies for satellite systems in outer space. So my presentation is going to last around 30 to 40 minutes, and then I will take questions. So let's first start with a brief presentation of what is the ITU. So in fact, ITU is a union member of the UN system. So we are a specialized agency of the UN system and dedicated to information and communication technologies. In fact, we existed much before the UN system because we were founded in 1865 as the International Telegraphic Union. At the time, it was in order to standardize the Morse code and also the interconnection rates of telegrams. Then we evolved in 1932, we became the International Telecommunication Union. And in 1947, after the creation of the UN, we joined the UN system. But we are still a specialized independent agency within the UN system. It means that we have some particularities, and one of the particularities is on this slide, we have a very diverse membership in the sense that 193 member states are the core members of the ITU, but we have also, and we are the only UN organization like that, we have also some private sectors that are members of the ITU. So the rights may differ, but they are true members, they are not observers, which means that they have, for example, the right to make proposals to the work of ITU. And for that, we have more than 900 industry and international organizations, and also more than 160 universities and academia that participate to our work. So our website is here, itu.int, you can have a look. And if you want to follow us on the social networks, I mentioned three of them. Finally, if EPFL or some of are interested to become a member of ITU, you can have a look at these links. Let's now move to the more substantial part of this presentation, of this webinar. It will be mainly consisting in two parts. I will first explain why we need to regulate at an international level the spectrum and orbits in outer space. And my second part will be about the steps that are necessary to follow to get access to radio frequencies for CubeSat, SmallSat projects. So I will focus on a specific kind of project, mainly CubeSat and SmallSat, probably the one that the Space Center of EPFL is more interested in. So let's start with why do we need such international regulations? Well, there are two main reasons that are highlighted on this slide. The number of hours is not because I am not aware that it is unreadable. It's really because to make you understand that there are many potential for, in fact, radio interference in space. So here you have all in dotted red arrows, the potential links that can create interference when you use a satellite system. So the two main reasons for international regulation in outer space for radio frequency usage is the first one, there is no national sovereignty in outer space. So this is provided by the Outer Space Treaty of 1967, which clearly states that there is no national appropriation or sovereignty in space. And therefore, the conduct of operation in space is regulated by international law. With regard to the use of radio frequencies in space, this international law, in fact, is embedded into one treaty that I will explain later. And the technical reason why we need these regulations is to prevent the radio interference between signals of different satellites to interfere with each other, which would prevent the smooth operation and the delivery of data through radio links. So the main reason is interference, and the legal reason is the absence of national sovereignty. both leads to the need for an international instrument, legal instruments, to cover the operation of radio frequencies in space. This is done by an intergovernmental treaty, which is called the Radio Regulations. So the Radio Regulations, it's not really a space treaty. It's a treaty about radio communications in general, both on Earth and in outer space. The first version of the of this treaty was agreed in 1906. So, and at the time, it was covering only two frequencies, and it was only covering the two frequencies that should be used by radio telegraph to transmit emergency message from ships. So you may know, for example, that during the Titanic wreckage, in fact, the Titanic send messages to get help. The main problem at that time was that nobody received it because nobody was listening on this channel. And following this catastrophe of the Titanic, the radio regulations became more and more detailed and also included not only technical harmonization, but also operational harmonization. So for the Titanic case, the operational harmonization that went afterwards was that every ship has also to listen to the radio channel, not only to emit on it. So this intergovernmental treaty, it has grown quite big since 1906. Since now we are regulating all the frequency spectrum between 8.3 kilohertz and 3 terahertz. And the treaty itself is more than 2,000 pages. The main purpose of this treaty, the radio regulations, is first to create some global spectrum. This is to say, to harmonize the use of radio spectrum through the world. This allowed economy of scales because the terminals can be smaller. This also allow roaming between countries, and it also allow interoperability. For space systems, the obvious interest in that is that with a globally harmonized spectrum, you can use frequencies all around the world and from space. The second purpose of this treaty is to create some regulatory uncertainty for several industries and applications that rely on the use of radio spectrum. And we do that, we provide this regulatory certainty by giving an interference-free operational environment. So if you apply the rules contained in the radio regulations, this leads to an operational environment for your satellite systems that will be free from harmful interference. The third point, it's not really a purpose, but it's the way we do that. This treaty is very different from others that you may have known. First, because this is a treaty that is regularly updated. We update this treaty every 4 years to maintain it in pace with technological advances. But we also update it only through consensus. We don't vote, or we don't use majority to decide the evolution. We use a consensus building approach. This requires some time, some effort, and some patience. The advantage, however, of that is that it creates a very strong compliance with this treaty. Currently, the 193 member states of the ITU have formally signed and ratified this treaty and comply with it. So this is a very strong power of this mechanism. So what are the main solutions or the main mechanisms that are used in this treaty to ensure an interference-free operational environment? Well, there are 5 of them mainly that are designed to control interference and also to ensure an equitable access between various projects. So the first of these mechanisms is called frequency allocation. And to do that, in fact, what the treaty is doing is that it takes the radio frequency spectrum. This is a continuum between 8.3 kilohertz up to 3,000 gigahertz. And it splits its segment, if you will, this continuum into smaller bands. So in these frequency bands, we allocate this frequency band to certain radio services. And so we say, okay, between this frequency, this is internationally harmonized for broadcasting, terrestrial broadcasting, for example, FM broadcasting, between 87 and 107 megahertz. This is dedicated to radio FM broadcasting. Similarly, there are frequency bands dedicated to space operations, sometimes on an exclusive basis, but also sometimes shared with other operations. So this mechanism of allocations allows a first level, a first layer of homogeneity among the various users of the band. The second mechanism to ensure the control of interference is that within each band, the treaty imposes some power limits, to make sure that the various systems that share the band do not exceed these limits and do not, I would say, break or destroy the homogeneity that we are trying to create. Because the more heterogeneous are systems, and the more likely they are going to interfere with each other. So the ERP, these power limits, have also the aim to ensure that the systems coexisting in the same band do not interfere with each other. However, it may not be sufficient. And that's why we have a third mechanism, which is a coordination. So for all the systems that respect the allocation mechanism and that comply with the power limits, well, between them, they can still create interference if they are not properly coordinated. That is to say, we ensure that member states that operate these systems discuss together and make detailed technical computations and operational considerations so that at the end, they know that two systems are compatible. And what we do is that we do that for each pair of systems. And so at the end, this series or this set of national and bilateral coordination ensure that all the systems are coordinated and can operate together without creating radio interference. In order to manage this coordination process, the member states need to know with whom they have to discuss, because it's very good to say you have to discuss between radio systems, but if you don't know who operates the radio systems, it's difficult to discuss. That's why the ITU maintains an international database called the Master International Frequency Register, which contains the list of all frequencies used in outer space, but also in terrestrial systems. And with this database, in fact, we have the complete list of frequencies that are either in use or planned to be used for satellite systems. With as such, the administration can consider this database and can use it as a basis for their technical discussions. And finally, when you have done all this process, national administration will issue license to user of radio satellite system. And these license will allow you to operate your system. Of course, all of that works if the administrations issue licenses that are compliant with the allocation, the power limits, the coordination mechanism, and the recording, but also if the licensees, the company or the individual that receives the license is operating in accordance with the license. And this is the role of the monitoring system, where national administrations check that they are to fit within the scope of their license. So this is the five main mechanisms, and we'll now going to see. So this is really the basis why we need international regulations for spectrum and orbits. Of course, the details are quite long. As I mentioned, the radio regulation is more than 2,000 pages, and I would say a good quarter of it is about space systems. So the details is much more complicated, but this is really the main principle. I will now move to the second part of this presentation, which is more about the practical steps to get access to radio frequencies for CubeSat SmallSat project. So I am assuming that you are interested in building and launching a CubeSat or a SmallSat. It has not to be necessarily a CubeSat, but something really small. So the assumption is that this is a small project, so a small satellite. The second assumption is that you want to send it one by one at least. You don't plan a constellation or a flock or a cloud of satellites. And also that you don't plan it necessarily more than for educational purposes, that is to say for the in the course of the university or the EPFL activities. So, as I mentioned, the first system that we use is that we allocate radio frequency bands to specific systems. So, on the international level, you need first to look at what are the appropriate frequency bands to operate your system. So, you need to find some frequency bands that are usable by satellite systems. To do that, there is an international table of frequency allocations contained in the radio regulations. The radio regulation, by the way, is freely available at the link that I mentioned on this slide. So you can download it. And if you look to Article 5, you will see what I have explained. You will see the radio spectrum, the continuum of the radio spectrum segmented by band. And then you need to find a band where you are comfortable to work within this frequency range from a technical point of view, and when it is legally possible to operate a satellite system in it. The importance, however, is that the frequency bands allocated to a space service must be chosen to match the purpose of the mission with the regulatory allocations. So, for example, we have radio services for Earth observation satellites. Of course, these observation satellites cannot use the band allocated to telecommunication services. So you have, we need to match the purpose of your satellite with the radio services you want to use. Finally, this is an international consideration of the choice of the frequency band. Take care, however, at national level, there may be some additional restrictions. Some internationally allocated frequency bands may be reserved for governmental use at national level. So in this case, you may not have access to it. And also some internationally allocated frequency bands may not be allocated nationally. That is to say, a country has the right to decide not to use this band because the radio regulations is, I would say, an international treaty that says that administration will not use more than what is said, but they have the right to use less. So sometimes some internationally allocated frequency are not allocated nationally. So you have to check that with your national regulators. In Switzerland, this is BACOM. I will mention it later. Continuing, I would just like to address some facts and myths about the frequency bands for satellite system. So first myth, there is no license exempt band for space systems. It's not it's not like Wi-Fi or things like that. In space, all bands are licensed. Some bands are easier to use. Maybe some bands have smaller licensing requirements, but there is no license exempt band for space services. Moreover, some people are tending to use the license exempt or the so-called band for terrestrially. That is to say, for example, the Wi-Fi band. You may wish to say, okay, I will emit and I will see if my satellite is receiving. Take care, because that may work in some bands, that may not work in some others, because the terrestrial bands that are exempt from individual licensing in some parts of the world may be heavily used by license systems in other parts. A good example, it's what we call the GSM band, the band for mobile telephony in Europe. In fact, in the Americas, this part of this band is used for license exempt or for terrestrial system not individually licensed. And therefore, it is tempting for a university in the US to to consider this band. But please understand that it may interfere from space with European or Asian systems. The second important point, the amateur bands can only be used for amateur purposes. So there are a number of amateur satellite bands that are very often used by universities. That's a good as long as it is for educational purpose. And it has to be carried out by radio amateurs, that is to say people that have a radio amateur license. The good thing is that, however, if it complies with this aspect, then the International Amateur Radio Union is helping a lot to coordinate these amateur satellites. And I have put the link here to, for you to look at. This is important, especially in a university like EPFL, if you plan ultimately to use something that is started as, a, as an educational project, but you want that to become maybe, if it works, a commercial venture. So sometimes university projects are successful and then they become, in fact, a commercial venture. One, this is of course possible. The only thing is that it has to be clear that as long as it is an educational satellite, it can use the amateur bands. When it becomes a commercial venture, even if it is not a profitable one at the beginning, as soon as it is a commercial enterprise, then it cannot use anymore the amateur satellite band. So it may be interesting sometimes not to choose the amateur satellite bands if you believe that on the long term you would like to see this evolving towards a more a commercial company. Then one other miss is that a telecommunication CubeSat does not become an Earth observation CubeSat simply because it has a camera on it. I invite you to download the radio regulations and look at the definition of an Earth exploration satellite service, and you will see that it's more than taking just some photography. And finally, an important reminder, choosing a wrong frequency band may prevent your mission to be launched or operated. You may choose a wrong frequency band, then at a certain point in time, you will have to get the license to launch the satellite, and you will have also to get the license to operate the stations communicating with the satellite. If the frequency band is wrong, then you may never get this license, and so you will have the object, but you will never get the official authorization to operate it. So coming back on selecting the best frequency band for CubeSat small sat missions. So a lot of CubeSats from university initially, they use the amateur satellite frequency bands. So around 144 megahertz, 435 megahertz and 2.4 gigahertz because they were for educational purpose. A second advantage of these intensive use is that the availability of radio equipment became very affordable, and then you have a lot of affordable radio interface integrated that can be integrated on CubeSat. But as I mentioned, these bands are restricted to amateur satellites only, and this may not reflect the variety of CubeSat missions, even from an university. And since now, almost technically, they can use almost all frequency bands across the entire radio spectrum. The best way to select the most appropriate frequency bands is really to ask for advice. If you are satisfied with the amateur satellite bands, don't hesitate to use it. If you believe that a little bit more is needed, do not hesitate to contact your national regulator. So in Switzerland, this is BACOM, or in German, or Ofcom in French. I have put their link here. You can also contact us, no problem, for specific questions. And I have put the general email address from the IQBR. So finally, what are the specific procedures to get the frequencies? So when you have selected your frequency, you have started building your satellites. You remember that I mentioned that there is this coordination mechanism between administrations. And I will explain a little bit how it works for you to understand. So First thing, which is very important, this process is a process between ITU member states, because only the member states have signed the treaty, and therefore they are the international parties that have committed to the to respect the duty of the treaties, the treaty, but that have also in exchange got the rights associated with the treaty. So the administration that is sending or that is submitting the request for getting some frequencies is called the notifying administrations. The administrations that operate systems already existing and that can be interfered with the by the newcomer are called the affected administrations. So, so this is a process that can last up to a maximum of 7 years. So I know that for you it should seem very, very long, but I insist this is a maximum. It has not to last for 7 years. Simply, after 7 years, if you have not materialized your project, then you have to start again. So what you do to get some satellite frequency, you initiate the process by sending an advanced publication of information. So this is a list of information that are standardized and that describes your project. So basically it says, okay, I want to say, to launch a satellite in such orbit with such radio parameters, using such frequencies, with such power, communicating with such stations on the ground. So you will send, so as a project, a satellite project, you will contact your national regulator back home, and you will ask them to send to us, to ITU, this description. When they have sent it, then we publish this advanced publication of information after checking that this is in conformity with the radio regulations. And we publish it internationally, so all the countries that are members of the ITU receive this publication. And these countries now have 4 months to examine and decide whether this new project may interfere with their existing satellites and existing projects. If yes, they send you back what we call the comment. And this comment says, oh, take care, we may need more discussions together, more detailed discussions, because there may be a problem. If they believe there is no problem, then they either send nothing or they send a letter saying, oh, no problem. And you don't count them anymore. You don't have to take them into account anymore. So after this 4 months period, what the BR is doing is that we are publishing a second document, which is a list of all the countries that have make a negative comment that have said that they need to discuss more. And then there are some bilateral consultation between the satellite operators of both countries and the countries themselves, only with the countries that have sent their comments in time, that is to say the countries that are listed in the APIB. And when you have successfully concluded your bilateral consultations, you will send to ITU the second document, which is in fact the description of the final characteristics of your project, the one that you have agreed with other countries. So we will take these final characteristics. We will then check also that they are in conformity with the international radio regulations. And we will include them in the Master International Frequency Register, the MIFR that I spoke before. And therefore, you will be recorded. And this is now up to the newcomers to discuss with you to make sure that you are not interfered. So this is globally the time frame and the sequence of event. It has to be clear, as I mentioned, that the 7 years is really a big maximum. Normally, the minimum duration of the ITU process is about 6 months now, but it's reasonable for a CubeSat project to plan for 9 to 18 months. 9 months if it is a simple one, 18 months if it is the most more complicated one. In particular, if amateur satellite frequencies are planned to be used, as I mentioned, the International Amateur Radio Union is helping you in doing the international coordination. And because they are helping you, it's reduced considerably the duration. It's still a minimum of 6 months, but it's really close, more close to 6 to 9 months than to 18 months. So this is also the advantage of these frequencies. Two important things. There is no need to wait until the completion of the satellite, the object, to initiate the ITU procedures. You can send the API, the first description, when you are reasonably comfortable with the frequency band you want to use and the orbit you plan. And this is the second point. You don't need to have a precise knowledge of the orbital characteristics to initiate the procedure. If you look to the time frame here, the first document you send is a general description. So it's fair to say, okay, I plan to launch at 500 kilometers or 600 kilometers. And then at notification, when you know, when you have discussed with other countries, but also when you have launched your satellites and that your satellite is operational, it's okay for us that you can send the exact value of the orbit. If the orbit is, 580 kilometers, then you will send this value. So this is important because this is often a situation that we face with CubeSats from either universities or from small companies. People really wait up to the last moment to send these documents and expect that these documents are going to be very quick. In fact, the documents are quick, but the exchange of discussions with the other administrations takes some time, so you have to plan for it. This is important because some launchers will not accept to launch your satellite if you don't have any API. Most of the launchers, in fact, will not accept. But some country as well will not accept to give you a license if you have not completed the ITU process. So this is something to take into account also when you design and prepare a satellite. So this was the, I would say, the main point of this second part, how to get access in practical terms to frequencies. Before answering your questions, I just want to summarize the key points of this presentation. The first things to remember really is that the use of all radio frequencies in space is regulated by the radio regulations. The second thing is that this is an international treaty that is regularly reviewed to accompany technical evolutions. So the regulations may change from time to time. And really, if you have any questions, don't lose too much time or don't waste too much time finding the answers. If it is not obvious from you, for example, if having read the radio regulations, you have found nothing or you can't even find it in the radio regulations, do not hesitate to contact either your national regulator, BAFCOM in Switzerland, or the ITU Radio Communication Bureau. You can either contact this generic email address that I mentioned at the end of the bottom of this slide, or you can also contact me directly if you have a specific question. And really, this is really the two main things that I would like you to really remember is that all frequencies are regulated by a treaty. So don't expect that you can launch a satellite without going through this process. So if you are able to do it, there is something wrong and you will get in trouble at a certain point in time. And second point is really do not hesitate to ask for help or for assistance. This is very often a much easier way than to waste a lot of time and energy to find the appropriate document. So the final consideration, or maybe a kind of advertisement, is that if you're interested by this presentation and would like to understand a little bit more the details of this international process to get access to the frequency spectrums, next week there is a World Radio Seminar organized by ITU that is beginning. This is a virtual event, and the first week is open to all. The second week is reserved to our members, because this is a very detailed trainings. But the first week is open to all participants. This is going to be virtual. There are two sessions per day, one in the morning, one in the afternoon. The two sessions are intended to cover exactly the same program. They are just here to make sure that we can reach every possible time zone. So in Switzerland, you have the opportunity to choose which session is preferable for you. And you can have a look at the program, and also you can register to follow it at the link that I mentioned at the bottom of this slide. Then, if you download the presentation, there is a number of annexes where I have put a number of links towards useful documents. I'm not going to really give detail on that. If you're interested, this is just a practical annexes with links to several interesting ITU documents. So with that, I think that's conclude my presentation, and I will now move to the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alexandre, for this really insightful presentation. For the questions, I think we can start. There has a few questions on the chat. I think the first question from Nina, she was asking if the database is available for the public. I think she was referring to the Master International Frequency Register.
Okay, so no, only a part of it is available. The list of entries to this database is public, but the detailed characteristics in this database are not. They are not very limited, because as soon as you are a member of the ITU, you can get it, but they are reserved to our membership. So the list of entries can be accessed, and I can give you, I can put on the chat the link.
Ah, cool, yeah. And also on this database, so Jean-Paul Kneib was asking if the military communication were also in this database.
Yes, so for military communications, we have a specific provision in the ITU constitution which says that member states can or cannot use this treaty for their military system. So they are not obliged to use it, but most of military satellites are registered in our database. The ones that are not registered are really those that are very, very secret. So those that normally should not even be aware of it. Mm-hmm. What is important to understand is that if you are not registered in our database, you don't have the duties, of course, of the radio regulation, but you don't have the rights neither. So you are not protected from harmful interference. Mm-hmm. So for certain military communication satellites, it does not matter. For some others, it matters. And so those for which it matters are registered in our database.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then the next question, I think there was a little discussion to understand which was the national table for Switzerland about frequency allocation. So I think there was a link on the Ofcom, so which is the Backcom. So this is for Swiss satellites, and it's also I would say compliant with the also international regulation.
Yeah, exactly. So you remember that I mentioned that one of the mechanisms in the treaty is to allocate frequency bands at the international level. Mm-hmm. So what is done, and then I also mentioned that at national level, there may be some differences. Mm-hmm. And you have here a very good example. In fact, each country take the international allocation table, mm-hmm. and they translate it into their national table.
Okay.
So basically, they create from the international table a national table, and as I mentioned, this national table may be more restrictive than the international one. So some bands, for example, that are allocated in the radio regulations may not be found in the national table. The reason is that in the international table, the radio services are compatible internationally, which means that, for example, a space service in France is compatible with another terrestrial service in Switzerland. Mm-hmm. But we do not study, or we do not guarantee that these two services are compatible in the same area or in the same country. So, for example, a satellite service may not be compatible with a terrestrial service just close to it. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why there may be differences between the international and national table. So you have the link to the Swiss mm-hmm. Table, which is very useful indeed, and this is one to follow.
Okay. So thank you very much. Then again, a question from Professor Kneib about what about interferences produced by satellites with ground-based radio telescopes?
Yeah, that's also a part of the mechanism of the radio regulation. So the radio telescopes are using radio services, which is called the radio astronomy services. Mm-hmm. And therefore, there are some frequency bands that are allocated to this service. In this frequency band, these radio telescopes are protected from interference through certain a number of international mechanisms and a number of international technical mechanisms that, which is this is a little bit technical. This is called an EPFD limit, so an equivalent power field density limit. The objective being to limit the emissions of the satellites toward the radio telescopes when they get in view of the radio telescope. So we have a document explaining how this is done. If you give me just a second, I will. Show the link in the web in the chat. So it's ITU. Yeah, so we have a document mm-hmm. explaining the protection of the radio telescope. This is this document.
Thank you.
And we have also some documents explaining how to convert these protection requirements into maximum level of protection of emissions from satellites. So if you combine both, then you have defined the level of protection given to the radio telescopes.
Okay. Does this answer your question, Professor Kneib?
Yep. Thank you.
Then I see, yeah, so for the presentation, it will be available. You can ask to candice.nord@epfl.ch. So that was the next question, if the presentation will be available. So this is a yes. Then I have a question from Hannes asking, how do you get your specific frequency? Who can help select a specific frequency to minimize the amount of coordination?
Well, so first, your frequency has to be chosen, I would say, first on a technical basis. That is to say, you have a satellite project, you define which is a frequency range where you want to operate. When you have defined this frequency range in a broad manner, you can have a look first either in your national table of frequency allocation or in the international table to select the subbands that can be used. Then how to select a frequency that minimizes the amount of coordination? It really depends on your needs for your project. If you have an educational satellites for university purpose, the best indeed is to go into the amateur satellite bands, because then you will get the assistance of the International Amateur Radio Union. Mm-hmm. This assistance is really powerful in the sense that you will send to them a description of your project, make sure that it complies with the amateur definition. And if yes, they will do all the work for you. They will coordinate and give you a yes or no. And we can also discuss with them to get a very specific frequency. Mm-hmm. So in this sense, this is very easy. But the caveat or the important point is that it has to be an amateur. If it is not amateur, then you enter into the field of more complicated things, because then you will have to select a frequency bands. And this is where you need to get access to the database. So you need to contact your national regulator to discuss with the national regulator what specific frequency band has the most chance to get coordinated easily.
Mm-mm. Yeah, and I think you gave also the contact on your presentation, so that's very nice. Yeah, then another question from Professor Kneib. Future 5G constellation satellites projects are booming. Would it not be better to have a single operator, economy of scale, and use of the frequency bandwidth rather to have many competing constellations?
From a technical point of view, yes, it could make sense. Unfortunately, it's almost impossible because this is then entering into the field of economic regulations. And maybe something that I've not mentioned, ITU is a technical body. We have international rules for technical aspects. We do not regulate at all the economic aspects. So our point is that as long as technically your satellite is compliant with our regulations, then you can do it.
Okay, thank you. I do have a question also, because you mentioned that you can use radio amateur frequency for educational purposes at API, like if it's an educational satellite, but as soon as you like maybe start to be commercial, you have to switch to ITU process. But what about scientific mission? Do they come into amateurs, or they're like seen as commercial?
Yeah, just first clarification. Even if you use the amateur frequency bands, you have to go through the ITU process. It's simply that the International Amateur Radio Union will help you with this part of the process. If I may go back to another slide.
Yeah.
The part of the process where I mentioned bilateral consultation with countries having spent common time, the International Amateur Radio Union will help you to do these consultations.
Mm-mm.
But you still have to do the process.
Okay.
For scientific missions, it's like for commercial missions. You have indeed to send the frequencies registration to ITU. Normally, however, if you are really in a scientific mission, then you will get in contact with all the space frequency agencies, like ESA or the others. Mm-hmm. And they do have also a mechanism of coordination between themselves. So, for scientific mission, you can in fact use first the scientific community to choose your frequency best, and then to also make sure that these bilateral consultations works well. So this is called the SFCG, the Space Frequency Coordination Group. This is a coordination group between space agencies.
Okay, thank you very much. Then I see there was another question from Hannes. Maybe you want to ask it because it starts to be kind of directly technical.
So thanks for your presentation. In case of this pretty standard 2 gigahertz space operations TMTC bands that most Earth observation missions use and all the big ESA satellites and so on, with the development of increasing number of satellites using these bands, and they're starting to become really crowded, and most satellites require more data rates or broader bandwidth, what is the outlook for the future? Will there be more S-band frequencies for these types of satellites, or is the way to go forward just going to higher frequency, or...
This is almost impossible to extend the frequency bands in 2 gigahertz for TMTC. The plan is that they are currently TMTC bands is 2 gigahertz, 7, 8 gigahertz, and then 25 gigahertz. As you mentioned in your question, they may not be all suitable for most missions, but in fact, the idea is to segregate between missions among the frequency bands. So the frequency bands that can use K bands, TMTC, they will use it and they will get in exchange more frequency available. Those that are intermediate, they can use the X band. The interest of X band is that if you are using, for example, the 8 gigahertz band for downloading your image or downloading your data, it's very appealing to also download your telemetry of the satellites in the same bands, And there is a 7 gigahertz allocation to, for the uplink, the telecom end of the satellite. So you only need one antenna in X-band to do both TM and TC. And if you have a certain requirements about the bit weight to download your data, this is probably the best band to go. 2 gigahertz will, in my view, continue to be used heavily, mainly for systems that require a limited amount of bandwidth so that they can share with others. If you really need more bandwidth, you really should look at X-band.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, before answering the next one, I noticed that there was one at the beginning that was not answered. It's about IoT services.
Thank you for noticing.
So indeed, the IoT services, they require very often frequency bands, not necessarily a lot of frequencies because the bit weights are quite low, but in very low frequency bands, below 1 gigahertz, generally it's better. 1 and 3 gigahertz is really the maximum. And the person asking the question is right, that currently there is no real clear bands identified for that. There are some around 400 megahertz, but their use is not so easy. So as I mentioned, the regulations are reviewed every 4 years. And this point is specifically discussed and studied for the next review. So the next review will be in 2023. And we are currently studying in ITU the possibility of having new allocations for these IoT services. So more frequencies available in addition of the 400 megahertz or the 2 gigahertz.
So I see that it's 54. So we'll take the last two questions that we have in the line in the chat, and then we'll have to close. I'm very happy to see so many questions. So another question, when the satellite is no more active, is ITU informed in due time?
Yes, the people inform us about the end of mission. So we remove the frequencies from the database. However, an important point is that because we have a database of frequencies, we manage a database of frequencies. We don't manage a database of satellite objects, which means that, for example, if you have a mission, the mission is very successful, you want to continue it and build and launch a second satellite, you can simply build and launch a second satellite and tell us, okay, the first one is retired, but I have a second one, so please do not delete my frequencies. And so as long as you use your frequency with similar satellites, you can continue to use it.
Okay, and then last question is, are there any regulation provisions for so-called short duration missions?
Yes, there are. However, they are very specific to two bands, which are allocated, as I mentioned in my slide, some bands are allocated specifically for short duration missions. And therefore, if you are not using these two bands, which is around 148 megahertz, and the second one is around 158. If you're not using these two bands, it's not very interesting to apply the regulatory provisions for these short duration missions, because in fact this is following a little bit the same process as the one that I mentioned, except that it creates additional requirements. So you have more requirements if it is not to use bands that are specifically designed for that. It's not very useful.
Okay, and so do we have the time for this last little question and then we really close?
Yeah.
I think it was also about when you were talking about the frequency. What is different if you mark constellation in the fielding? Is constellation when satellites work together for one purpose?
Yep, so in the way you submit frequencies to ITU, you can, in fact, submit one satellite, the case that I took for, but you can also describe a constellation of satellites, that is to say, a number of satellites working together. So if you mark constellation in the filing, yes, we will consider it as a constellation, that is to say, a number of satellites working together. They don't necessarily work for one purpose, they may have multi-purposes, but yes, indeed. The point is that we have been forced to expand the concept of constellations. So in some frequency bands, where a more detailed procedure is needed, and I have not shown it here. Everybody is a constellation, even if you have one satellite. But this is for bands that are very crowded and very used by for communications by the mega constellations as well.
Okay. And I think with this, we'll close this today's seminar. So thank you so much, Alexandre, for being there and answering all the questions. Thank you, everyone, also for attending today. Yeah. I see that we had maximum of 40 participants. So we're very happy, and stay tuned that we may also organize other seminars in the future from EPF Allspace Center. Thank you
very much.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Thank you all. Bye.